Everybody, welcome to a very special episode of WTCtv. Today I'm joined by Tony Vela. My name is Paul Anand, and we got a very, very special guest. We've got the one and only, for the first time to be seen by the hobby, the governor, Alan Barcoff. Alan, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, my pleasure. Tony and I, we do a regular series once a month, but we wanted to start meeting some of the more newer characters in the hobby. Now, you're not a new guy, Alan. You've been around for a while, but you've just not been exposed to the videos that we do. And if anybody out there follows you on social media, you're going to be saying to yourself, this guy's met every fucking wrestler, every celebrity, you know. So we've got a bunch of questions to talk to you about your personal business. And we're going to talk about graded photographs. Tony and I are going to get into the wrestling card hobby with you.
Sure.
But let's get right into it. I guess the first question is, what is it that you do for a living, man? I mean, you're either the craziest stalker I've ever met, or you're in the promotion business, or you deal. And we're going to talk to Tony as well, because he does a lot of bookings and appearances as well. But what's your story? What do you do for a living, Al?
Who the hell is the governor?
Yeah, the governor. Who are you?
Governor. So I do marketing. I do strategic maneuvers. I do a lot of PR. I'm just very good at hyping stuff. Even before social media, we didn't have this. Obviously, in the 80s, you had to do it the hard way, you know. And I just was good at mouth to mouth, telling people about stuff going on and getting it out, and using print media, you know, magazines, to put ads and talk about things and get things rolling. And I started going to the hotel in Manhattan where all the baseball players and basketball players stayed when they came to play the Yankees and Mets. And I was getting autographs, and I was meeting players. And Andre Dawson was one of my favorite players. And I had read that Andre was trying to raise money for sickle cell anemia, one of his charities. And I had some ideas. So when Andre came out of the hotel, I approached him politely. And I said, Mr. Dawson, I know you're trying to raise money for sickle cell anemia. I have some ways I think we can make a lot of money pretty easily. He goes, well, take a walk with me. I like to hear about this. I was surprised how easy that was. And we walked for a while. He goes, let's get something to eat. Let me hear more about this. And I said, Andre, why don't we do an ad in Sports Collectors Digest, which was a huge, huge publication back then for the hobby. It was like 300 pages. And I said, we'll put an ad. We'll say, Andre Dawson, we'll autograph your personal items, trading cards, bats, balls, photos. And Andre will also be selling his game used equipment. And he loved that idea. He says, we can make money doing this. And I was like, yes, we really can. Let me put the ad in and let's see what stuff comes in. And next trip you're in, you can sign the stuff and I'll have a check for you. And he says, let's do it. I think that sounds really marvelous. And it worked out so well. I mean, oh my goodness. You know, this was a pretty new thing at the time.
When was it specifically? Then what year?
This was like 1985.
Wow. So you were like really ahead of the curve.
Yeah. This was like something people just weren't doing back then. You know, I just had a vision of it. We put the ad in. Like I said, it was like gangbusters. Because Andre at that time was one of the biggest superstars in baseball. So for people, they have the opportunity to get their items autographed by Andre and to get game used equipment from him, you know, right from him, was big. And then he introduced me to Tim Raines, which was his best friend and also another big superstar. Tim was trying to raise money for Seminole High School. And I said, Tim, let's do the same gimmick I did with Andre. Same thing. He goes, I heard about it. He goes, I'm all for it. And we did the same thing. And it just really went from there. And they introduced me to a lot of players. So that's just kind of how I got my start. Is one player vouches for you to another player. It's kind of just keeps going. Hey, what can you do for me? What ideas do you have? And then, boom, you just keep meeting people like that.
What got you wrestling? What is the connection to wrestling? Oh, we lost him.
Oh, we lost him.
Yeah, got you back. So that's just kind of how it started. And then it was funny. I was outside the hotel with Andre Dawson another time. This very well-dressed man sees us and he says, excuse me, aren't you Andre Dawson? And Andre says, yes, I am. He goes, I'm a big fan of yours. Yada, yada, yada. But this guy was just dressed like immaculate. You can tell this guy came from wealth. And before you know it, you know, I stayed in contact with this guy. He knew all the pro wrestlers. And you're like, what are the odds of that? And he says, brother, come by the wrestling hotel. All the wrestlers stay there. I'll introduce you. You know, because he was so impressed with Andre. Andre gave him an autograph. Andre, you know, we chatted with him, and he thought I was the greatest thing. He figures, if I know Andre Dawson like that, I must be a good guy. So he invited me into his world. And this guy, Tom, opened a million doors for me. I can never thank that man enough.
Wow. That's incredible. Yeah. Networking is a powerful thing, man.
It really is. So the wrestlers used to stay at the Ramada Inn about 5 minutes from Madison Square Garden. So the shows back in the day were once every Monday, every month, or one show a month.
Right. Yep. Well, you've mentioned before, Tony, in your business that once you sort of get in with a few, then you meet others and the word travels.
Again, it's just a matter of networking is really all it is like that. I mean, yes. Just this weekend alone, you know, I was with Kurt and down in Louisiana, and on the trip back, it's really Shreveport, Louisiana. Don't recommend. End up having lunch with Godfather. So just, you know, I've known him and met him many, many times over the years, but never had an actual sit down meeting with the guy and talking to him. And, what a pleasure it was to sit there, but that's how it works. It's just, hey, you're Kurt's boy, right? Yeah. I am like that. Yeah. Yep. I heard some good things.
Exactly. That's exactly how it is. Once someone vouches for you and that other wrestler or that other player trusts that person's judgment, and then they see that you're a nice guy, because I can tell you are. You're easygoing. They love that. They don't want screaming fans. They don't replicating their verbiage. They get that shit every second.
That's why I coined this term years ago. It's like that. I call people like that who want to get in the business, I call them fanagers.
That's a good one.
Nice. But that's kind of what they are. So, but you get to the networking part of it. And, you know, like you said, Alan, it's about people vouching for you. And when you do good things for those people, they say, hey, I mean, that's how I ended up working with Scott Hall in the last years of his life, because, you know, Nash vouched for me, and we were, you know, Scott and I were going back and forth through text messages. And I just said, can you just talk to Kevin for me? Because he didn't understand the concept of how Comic Cons worked. He was so used to doing just wrestling type things and being bought out deal. And then that person makes whatever they make on top of that. So, well, it works differently in the pop culture-y Comic-Con world. He couldn't grasp it. So he talked to Kevin. Like 20 minutes later, I get a text message from Scott. I'm in.
Yeah. So that's how it is. And as you know, of course, Scott and Kevin, best of friends. So, you know, if Kevin says to Scott, this guy is good, he's not even going to question. It's like, done, you know.
Another which is good, Alan, is that you've kept all your photos from over the years. A lot of people, you know, would lose them or whatever, but you've got pictures going back to when you were just a kid, like you say, in the 80s and then the 90s, and it's not just wrestling. I mean, what attracted us to you was the fact that you know so many wrestlers, but you cover all sports. Now, do you do business with all these people, or a lot of them you just sort of meet peripherally through the guys you're dealing with?
It's a combination of both. I mean, because I'm just kind of connected in New York City. I know a lot of people that own restaurants, that own hotels, that own clothing shops. So with baseball, because my friend owned a really nice clothing store a few blocks away from the Grand Hyatt, that's where the baseball players stayed. The players always want to get nice clothes. It's New York City. We're the fashion capital of the world. I would say, hey, I got a great shop. The guy's a good guy. I would take them over to the shop. That opened a lot of doors for me, because now I'm going to get some money off of this. You know, the owner would say, hey, Al, if these guys spend money, I'll cut you in, bring all the players, tell them about it. And players started talking about it. And it's, oh, that guy Al's good. He'll bring you over to the store. He's, you know, good guy, good clothes, good prices. So it's so many things like that, how I started getting in with more baseball players. And it was basketball players, same thing. They were staying at the hotel. And at the time in 85, nobody went for basketball. I used to wait so that the baseball team bus would leave at 4:30 to take them to either Shea or Yankee Stadium. Then if there was a game at the Garden that night for basketball, that team bus would leave a half hour later. I would just go upstairs, wait for that bus. Michael Jordan's coming out, all these guys, but nobody gave a shit back then. It was the weirdest thing, seeing Michael Jordan walk out of a hotel. I'm the only person waiting for him.
That's crazy.
And beyond sports too. Like I've seen some of your pictures too with musicians and you know, even some important figures that you met over the years too.
Oh, I appreciate that. Yeah. So Johnny Ramone from the famous band, the Ramones, he was a huge autograph collector of Yankee photos. He wanted to have every Yankee on a signed photo. And Johnny was the most nondescript, easygoing guy for being a major rock and roll superstar. He never wanted to be treated like that. If you treated him like a superstar, wouldn't give you the time of day. He just was Johnny, and that's it. So I would see him at all these shows, and he knew I was getting autographs in person. He says, "Hey, you getting anything new? What you got?" And I said, "I got some stuff." And he says, "Let me know first." And I said, "Of course, Johnny." And he always paid well. He says, "I'm going to do something nice for you." He goes, "The New York Music Awards are coming up. I'm going to get you a backstage pass, and you can just roam around and do what you want." I was like, holy, holy smokes, what the F? Yeah. And he gave that to me. And like I said, I was meeting LL Cool J and all these humongous Run DMC, all these huge rappers. And again, I got into the music business because people were like, "Wow, you know about stuff. You're marketing the way you speak." And again, it's just they invite you to other parties, and it just you keep going to more parties. Come to this thing, I'll put you on the list. And that's kind of how it all started. And awesome. I always had a camera with me, and I just always took pictures. I just loved photography since I was a kid. So
you kind of become a mini celebrity yourself, you know?
Oh, I don't look at it like that. I appreciate you saying that, but I'm just always humble about that. You know, I just find it fun, you know?
And I think that's why you get invited to these things. Like Tony mentioned before, that fanager, fanboy wrestlers don't want that. They want guys that are normal guys. Tony invited me to one of his things. Tony does booking and he represents guys and took me up to the green room where a bunch of wrestlers were floating around. And these guys, mingle, like normal guys mingle. But the last thing they want is someone, you know, wide-eyed and sort of, you know,
they hate that.
Especially
they
behind the scenes.
Yeah. They hate that.
Yeah, because nice. Usually you have phone calls with some of these guys sometimes, and some of them you develop these relationships with over the years, and you end up legitimately having a friendship with some of these people. Yes. And they will call you, you know, out of the blue, and you're not talking shit about, you know, the business at all. You're talking politics and family and sports and news and things like that. You know, it's just kind of how it is. You know, you start developing that kind of relationship with some of these people. So those are always kind of special.
No, I so agree with you. I like it. We can just, you know, somebody says, "Alec, I need a little advice about something. I want to start a business. What's your take on it? What can you kind of tell me about it?" Or, you know, something of that nature that they're trusting you with that they wouldn't trust. And I think that's kind of cool that you're building a legit friendship with them beyond wrestling. Because I always tell any athlete or singer, I said, tomorrow, if you quit being a rap superstar, you decide to be a lawyer, a doctor, work in Burger King, you're still my friend regardless. You know, I said, and that would never change. And they always appreciated that because most people, once your fame becomes less, people start to leave to the next hot thing. I don't do that. I never believed in that. That's not a friend. That's a bad human being.
I agree with you on that 100%.
Yeah, when they know you guys are down to earth, they want to deal with you. You know, they want to do business with you, and they just want to hang with you. Like that day you and Kurt were by the castle taking pictures. I'm like, Kurt Angle doesn't do that unless he likes the guy he's standing beside.
You talked about always taking a camera with you. Always love pictures like that. That's a great little segue into what we want to talk next like that. Yeah. You know,
sure.
Where do you think this market is going here with you know, graded original photos like that? Like you've posted so many, type one photos like that. Can you explain to people what those are, where you think they're going?
Absolutely. So again, I've always loved photography, but wrestling, who was really taking photos fan-wise in the 70s, 80s? Fans went to matches. They didn't bring cameras with them. MSG forbade you to bring a camera with a lens on it, you know, so all you can bring if you were a fan was a, you know, small camera. And if you didn't have good seats, you're not taking close-up pictures. So to get really good pictures from that era, it's really rare. It's mostly the photographers who worked for magazines that got the great shots. Mm-hmm. And most of that stuff, sadly, was thrown in the garbage and burnt a long time ago because it was clutter. Because who thought any of this stuff had any value? It's a photo of a wrestler. Like, think about it. Ric Flair wrestles six times a week. You see Rick back then six times a week. How many photos did you need of Ric Flair or Ricky Steamboat or Hogan? It just didn't matter. The magazines only came out once a month. They only would use maybe one photo. So a lot of the stuff is not out there. It's gone. So whatever is left, which is very little, I just feel is very valuable, you know, because most of these people only made one print. Because think about it. Back in the day, to develop film was very expensive. Making prints was expensive, and who's paying for it? These photographers were not exactly making $1 million working for the magazines. Yeah. So you're trying to cut expenses down. So there's no 15 copies of each photo from back in the day. It was probably just one.
So what made you, what why did you decide to, like, you know what, I'm keeping all this shit, because this is this, did you have the foresight to think this could be valuable someday, or just because you thought this was cool to keep and I want a record of my memories?
Yeah, it was what you just said. It was I've always liked to document my life. I always loved photos. My dad, you know, still alive, bless him, you know, always took a lot of photos, and he got me into photography. So I always had a camera, and I felt like this is kind of cool. You should take a picture with your friends or some wrestlers or some event. But I just always loved wrestling, and I loved the photos. This is like, it's just so cool. I just kept them. And then as years went on, I was just buying them from people who didn't want them. They didn't care. They'd sell me for a dollar. You know, oh, give me a dollar for this. Or, yeah, take these 100 photos. Give me $20, because who cared? You know, it was, yeah, had no value. And a lot of the magazines and stuff, they went digital. What they did was they scanned all their photos, put it on digital, and they threw all the rest of the shit out.
Right.
All the originals are gone, which is gone. Really sucks.
Yeah, you had your access allowed you to get some shots that are really fucking cool. Like, there's some pictures there of some big names in the past that have never been seen before in a magazine or anywhere else. You know, that's
especially ones that, well, especially talent together when you never really saw them together.
And behind the scenes, not out of the ring, but in a parking lot. And there was one you took the other day that clearly showed the era because of the car that they were standing beside. And I'm thinking, you know, that dates the picture. That's cool. Because like you say, we have, all of us have phones in our hands nowadays. So the world is constantly being photographed and videoed. Whereas back then, no. You know, so some of these things, Alan, that you have are really, really special. Talk to us about the grading. That's a very interesting subject, because they're starting to get graded now, and you're sort of leading the way on that insofar as letting people know about it and grading stuff yourself. Talk to us about that.
Yeah, so the type one photos get graded. You want type one. Type one means that's the original that was developed within 2 years, and it's not off another negative or developed, you know, 10 years later where the paper wasn't of that time period of 1981, 1982, and PSA is very good at identifying, you know, the paper used and when it was done. So you don't really want type two or type three, because that's not original. It's still a nice souvenir, but remember, it costs $80 per photo to get authenticated and encapsulated. There is very little room for error with this.
And what, so, since there's type one, two, and threes, there's gotta be obviously a significant price difference from those different levels.
Oh yeah. So type one, whether it be any sport, baseball, football, basketball, music, means that's the original. So yeah. If you have I have an Elvis Presley photo with Liberace. I'm a big fan of both of them. It was taken in 1956. The back is stamped 56. It was printed in the magazine. That's what you want. The type one, the original, the original negative. You don't want one that maybe that newspaper printed 15 years later to put in another magazine. It's still a nice something, but it's not an investment piece, is what I guess I'm trying to say.
Gotcha.
No, Tony, we've
the type before. Ones are the investments.
Gotcha.
Tony, we've talked before about the 8x10 market, right? And these aren't original pictures. These are obviously just photographs, 8x10s that have been printed or copied.
Yeah.
Or have you. And that market really hasn't taken off like trading cards or figures or even belts.
Yeah, true.
And then there's the a lot of them get signed. A lot of times that's what people have to get signed. What's your prognosis, Alan, for this market specifically? Just because now these are original photos, which are graded, which are a little bit different than copies of 8x10s. But just as a segment of the hobby, of the wrestling collecting hobby, when I mentioned belts and trading cards and figures, where do you see this falling in? Do you think it has that kind of growth potential that original photos like the ones you have and other guys that were around may have as well? Do you think there's a big money, or is it going to be sort of a niche section of the wrestling collectibles market?
I think it's a niche right now. I think, like you said, a lot of people have seen it and they're like, wow, I never knew of this, or this is so, it's so new. I just kind of introduced it. So sometimes things has to grow on people. But as you all guys all know, in the wrestling collectibles market, there are so few like things to really collect. After you kind of get a few things of somebody, now what? You know, what else is coming out? So I think these photos, especially when you have like Flair, Andre, Hogan, Dusty, that are like Ultimate Warriors, Savage, that are so collected and their fans are rabid, they always want something new and different. And I think that's what's going to catch on. It won't catch on to every wrestler, obviously, but I think the top wrestlers, the icons, it's going to catch on. And
I like that. That's something new and different, yet it's something that's actually old and original.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Well said. Yeah.
There's a massive Hogan market. There's a huge Andre the Giant, especially for his signatures. So, imagine, these are never before seen photos. Like, of course we have magazines, but these ones didn't even make the magazines. That's why it's very interesting to me. And that's why I think that when you post something, Alan, you get a ton of bites on it. People are like, wow, look at this, look at that. It's because it's something that we've never seen before. You know, you can make a trading card 10 sets a year and make fancy backgrounds and stamp them a million different colors and put all gold and all that shit on it. But you know, it's the same images. You know, like I might have a Hogan card today that I got in a heritage set in 2012 that I bought in a set in the 90s, you know, because there's only so many images, right? That's why the originality of some of these shots are what's really appealing to me, that, you know, never before seen shots of classic guys. A lot of guys, unfortunately, that aren't with us anymore. You know, that's why I think the market, has got a gap that you might be able to drive a truck through eventually, because I think there's going to be a lot of people that are, especially guys that are into the older stuff. We like to say vintage collectors versus modern.
Yeah.
Old school wrestling fans like me, like you, like Tony, you know, that know it going back to the days, you know, of the 70s and the Four Horsemen and Mid-Atlantic and all that stuff. You know, we're dating ourselves, but from that time to present day, and some of the pictures you got are just off the charts. They're just incredible. That's why
I appreciate that, because like I want to maybe explain one other thing quick is, if you look at some of the arenas back in the day, they were like wrestling in front of 1500 2000 people in very small arenas in small towns in Virginia. People just, again, didn't bring cameras with them. It's like, who wanted to schlep that with them? So you just watch the matches. So who really documented a lot of these matches or took pictures? Because like I said, the wrestling photographers didn't go to every town. Who could afford that? Right. So I think sometimes you might have had one person snap something and that's it. And there's just not a ton of it. There wasn't bringing cameras to wrestling matches. Just, I don't think, was the move. I was in Texas during the Von Erich era. Fans just didn't bring cameras really to the arena. Like, you even watch on TV, you don't see people in the rows with cameras, you know, taking shots.
Into the early to mid 90s, it's the same thing. Just before the internet, people still, you don't see a lot. Like, I mean, you had some guys like what they call the curtain call, you know, from Madison Square Garden, you know, that events like that. I mean, all we've ever seen is one particular video footage that some fan happened to be taking at the times, like that of,
like, the Zapruder film with Kennedy, you know, that one guy, right place, right time with a camera.
Exactly. So, I mean, it's just, now we live in that world now where everything is so readily accessible to us right here. It's like, and then who's actually taking non-digital pictures these days? It's always fascinating to me when I actually go and do these conventions, and you got that one guy or gal who comes to that line to meet, you know, whoever it is that I'm working with. And they got an old school.
Yeah.
It's like, we have this. Like, well, I like to have the hard copies.
There's something genuine about that era, though. There's something about the classic era. Because if you go to an event today, you know, when I go to the indie event around the corner, everyone's trying to catch the moment. They're not actually seeing it. They're trying to get it on their camera. Some guys have their videos going that they're looking at the event through a screen. And I'm thinking, blessed are the old days where we didn't have this technology, where you're forced to sit down, grab a drink, and actually view the event.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. I miss that. Yeah.
You know, I agree. It's a bit of a more innocent time, if you will.
I still miss the lighters at concerts, for Christ's sakes.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, I think a lot of kids miss a lot of shit because they're too busy trying to film it or take pictures of it, you know, and then tweet it or Instagram it and say, look, here's a picture that I was just at this event. Meanwhile, you ask them, like, I remember vividly, as if it, you know, locked into my brain, when Warrior kicked out, flipped Hogan, and 1-2-3 at Sky Dome and won the title. Not because I was watching it and waiting for it, you know what I mean? Now, had I been with a phone, you know, who knows what you remember, you know? So, you know, I'd much rather find your pictures after the fact.
Yeah, no, I always love taking pictures. And you're right, like, go to concerts and people are just watching it through their phone. And the artists themselves will say, can you guys put these cameras down? Yes. Like, I'm trying to entertain you. Like, you could have watched this on TV then if you could have your phone up. It's not as fun anymore.
It's a generation.
I liked going to MSG in the 80s. You know, we had all these fairs sold out. People were rabid. You know, you didn't have 10,000 signs. Everybody wasn't trying to be a smart mark. You just had fans that came, wanted to be entertained, and they go home and they were happy. And I do miss that a lot. It's a missing thing in wrestling today.
Speaking of the 80s like that, Let's segue real quick over here to good old wrestling all-star trading cards.
Sure.
Let's make sure we have some kind of cards involved here.
Because that's what we're all about here. And we know you got some very interesting thoughts on that. So you got the question, Alan, or you just want to go? Tell us about your experience with the all-stars and set us straight, if you will.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So, no, first of all, I want to say there are some people in the hobby right now who have tried to set a narrative that they created the wrestling all-stars market. They got them graded first, they got them signed first, and they, if they want to use the word tricked or convinced or manipulated people to believe that, hey, that's whatever. I didn't know about it. I wasn't really on Twitter in the wrestling stuff. I'm pretty new to it. You know, big shout out to Uncle Danny, who actually said to me, Al, introduce yourself to the wrestling community. They will be very appreciative of what you can bring, and you're a nice guy and you come off nice. You're not going to try to be a big shot, but show them your stuff and meet these people. And I said, I'll try it. And you guys have been freaking amazing. I love you guys. And I thank you, first of all. And so point is, so some people are trying to say they did all this first. I bought these wrestling all-stars when they first came out, 1982. So in the Madison Square Garden program that came out, you know, every month, had an ad, wrestling trading cards. I was like, holy shit. Being a baseball card collector since the 70s, I said, wrestling trading cards? Holy moly. I had to get these. I sent the money in the next day, and I got them like 2 weeks later. Then another set came out. So new ads. So I just kept buying the sets, and they came in the mail like within a couple of weeks. And they came in a brown, nondescript padded envelope. You would never know what you ordered. It wasn't some fancy envelope. It was just really very mundane. It was pretty funny.
They were like $5 or something. They're very inexpensive. I remember when I got
Yeah, they were $5, $6, maybe a buck for shipping, if I remember. It was very cheap.
Yep.
And they weren't even packaged well. They were just, the set was cellophane and just thrown into the padded envelope.
Yeah.
So a little background on that.
Time. You bought them at time. You didn't buy them a decade later. You bought them at the time as they were coming out.
Yes, I bought them literally when I saw the ad. I sent the money in the next day to get them. This is 1982. And then, of course, when the other 83 set came in, I was getting them right away. And being in New York, you got them fast, because I don't think the rest of the world even knew about them, to be honest, because I don't think the ads was in every magazine.
Right.
So by the time
how many sets do you think you probably end up getting?
I would say I think I bought three or four of each one, because I just wanted to get them autographed, was my thinking. You know, I wasn't really thinking at the time.
Uh-oh, he's muted.
Ric Flair rookies worth a lot of money. I just said, maybe I'll get them autographed, or they're just kind of cool to have. So I bought a few, and then I was, you know, getting them signed. Like I said, I went to the hotels, and wrestlers had never seen them before, because who was buying them? You know,
that's a huge pursuit for many in our hobby now, is getting them graded and signed after the fact. Now, did you ever do that? Did you ever have any of yours graded?
Yes. So I had some graded early. And again, because I had, you know, Ric Flair and Kurt Hennig, Adonis, Jimmy Hart. I had some tens in those. And a certain collector saw me. I had them up on eBay, and he hit me up and made a deal. But I was getting them signed already. So I had these signed in 82, 83, 84, 85. So I got to see a lot of these people and got a lot of them signed. And, you know, I had, again, please, I'm not saying it's to brag. I'm just saying this, we're having a conversation. I had the first Hulk Hogan done. You know, Ric Flair said I hadn't signed one of these in 10 years. I'd never put Nature Boy on this before. A lot of the wrestlers had never seen him. Dino Bravo, never seen him. Most of them didn't really care, to be honest. Like, they weren't like, oh my goodness. They were just like, oh, okay. You know, where did this come from? And they didn't really think anything of it, you know?
What was the most difficult one for you to acquire?
I can't say any of them were really that difficult, because the ones who did it for me were friendly to me. They kind of knew of me. So I'll just use an example, like Dino Bravo, for example, mostly didn't give fans the time of day. Not because he's a nasty guy, but he was a heel. And he just was kind of not a talkative guy to people. He kind of minded his business. Mm-hmm. But he signed a bunch for me. But in general, he's really tough to find. And if I didn't get them signed back then, I don't think there'd be any of them in the hobby, to be honest with you. So really? Bruiser Brody was another tough one, obviously. I saw him at an indie show, got him to sign some. But again, in general, Bruiser just wasn't accessible to fans. He stayed in that gimmick, you know?
Yeah.
And signing autographs for stacks of fans just wasn't his gimmick to do. It would have hurt his aura.
Guys got a good gimmick back in the day.
Did you ever get involved with any other early trading cards? Any, or was just the All-Stars?
I was getting the All-Stars. Then when the 85 All-Stars came out in that magazine, when you perforated it, I was getting those done. Hulk Hogan never saw that one before. You know, and he goes, oh, brother, you got an extra one of these for me, right? And I said, yeah, sure do. He goes, oh, good job, brother. You know, that's exactly what he said. Just like that, I gave him one in the limousine. And he was showing, it was in the limousine with Brian Blair and Brunzel, two very good friends of Hulk's. Just, I don't know if people know that, but yeah, those are two of Hulk's really dear friends. And they were looking at it, and they were like, oh, that's cool, da 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 da. But Hulk liked that card. Tonga Kid says, oh, I got a baseball card. Like, he was excited about it. That's what he called it.
A lot of guys, I think Nash even calls them. He calls them baseball cards.
Baseball yeah, cards. That's
he calls them baseball cards, and he calls action figures dolls.
Yeah, dolls. Yeah, I call it dolls too. But yeah, then I was getting like when the Topps cards came out, I got those signed too. The 85 Topps, the 85 Opeachy, then the 87s came out. You know, Dino Bravo signed a whole bunch of those for me, like that triple. It was Dino Bravo, Valentine, and Johnny V. And he sent a whole bunch of those for me. I wish I knew where they were. I sold them, and I would love to for them to see them resurface somewhere.
Do you have any card trading cards that you've had over the years, you've gotten signed over the years? Have you kept any for yourself at all?
I actually sold all of them. I got out of autographs a long time ago as far as collecting. And I just one day said to myself, the photos with me and the wrestlers, and I had Polaroids. So I was doing Polaroids in 85 with the wrestlers because I can get them to sign the bottom, like right there.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a lot of those done. And to me, that was more important. Like Big John Studd signing to Allen, Big John Studd on the bottom of a photo of me and him meant more to me than just the signed cards.
Totally. I totally get that.
So that's kind of what I did. So I just kind of sold like almost everything to different people. And yeah, I don't regret it. You know, it's like I liked getting it, but I like the photos of me and the wrestlers. That's really my niche, like what I like. It brings me back, you know, great memories to great times in my life.
Well, how do you feel and think about the market today, seeing that people are really jonesing for all these signed wrestling All-Stars and Tops, you know, all these different cards? I mean, what's your take on everything going on right now?
I think it's great. It's wrestling is a great thing. It brings people together. It's a fun sport. I'm glad it took off. I'm glad there's people out there want to buy it. I'm glad people are trying to upgrade sets. It's really cool. Like Uncle Danny, he just purchased that nice, you know, 8.5 Hogan with a 9 autograph. I mean, that's a beaut. That's gorgeous, you know, and he's a passionate collector. Yeah, you know, Uncle Danny is amazing. He's a passionate guy. I just want to say I got so much respect for him because we were talking about the Andre the Giant signed Wrestling All-Stars card many months back, and it was up for sale on eBay, and he says, oh, I don't know where you should buy it. I said, Danny, if you want to be, you know, top dog, if you don't have the Flair, Andre, and Hogan signed All-Stars, you cannot do any bragging. You have to have the big three. You have to. And I said, grab it. I said, you may never effing see another one again. And he goes, oh, maybe you're right. I said, do it. Get it. Just effing get it. And he went and got it. And I have big respect for somebody who backs up their play, so to speak. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, speaking of Uncle Danny, he was in, Tony and I did the Collector's Card Series, and he was in Series 1. And we're happy to announce that you, sir, are going to be in Series 2.
Oh, that is awesome, man. Thank you so much. Oh, man. Big thumbs up for that one.
So we're looking forward to that. We're in the middle of putting that together now, and we've already got your card done, as you know. We'll be talking to you about the backs of that, but we're excited to have you. Someone with your sort of pedigree, a guy that's been in the hobby or around wrestling, around wrestlers. You know, like when I met Tony the first time, we were at a hotel one night, and he was showing me picture after picture, him and Vince, him and everybody. And I thought, dude, you sure do know a lot of wrestlers, until Alan came along. The guy,
that's right.
Like, oh, step aside, son.
That's exactly it. I go, I'm just going to go ahead and step aside over here.
Oh, man. No, it's just all good. Everybody just does good things. And that's what I like. I like when everybody succeeds and everybody has fun stuff. That's what this is supposed to be out.
Group, you know, the wrestling sort of online collectibles, online trading cards, you know, in the last few years, you know, Tony and I sort of been on the front lines with our show and meeting people and doing stuff,
yes.
You know, and it's a good group of guys, you know, like you say, like when you describe Danny, passionate guys, smart guys, guys that care about each other. So before we let you go, let's maybe pick around a couple of stories, maybe let us know some of the more exciting things or you know, which wrestler when you met impressed you the most, or just share something that you think our audience would find interesting about somebody.
Oh yeah, I'll start with Kurt Hennig. You know, Kurt was just really a nice guy, a huge baseball fan. When I say huge, I mean he loved baseball probably more than wrestling, and that's kind of how I hooked with Kurt. He just loved baseball, and he heard me over talking with him about baseball, and he goes, "Ah, you're a Don Mattingly guy." I was like, "Yeah," because I love Don, and he loved Kirby Puckett and Kent Herbeck because that was his hometown twins, and that kind of got me in with Kurt because we're talking about baseball. So again, just something that he enjoyed talking, nice and quiet. And then he saw my friend had all these old wrestling photos from the 70s, and he goes, "Okay, I take a look through them." And we're like, "Holy smokes, here's Kurt Hennig." You know, Mr. Pert, you know, going through him, and he just said, "Let's sit down, have a beer." And he's just looking through this box of photos, and Adrian Adonis comes over, and Honky Tonk, all these guys are looking at him, and they're showing him around. And Baron Cicluna was in the bar that night, and there were some old ones of him, and he was like so embarrassed, but he was laughing because everybody was like ribbing him and like, "Look at this when you are actually winning matches." And it was just like a really fun time, you know, in a bar after the matches at MSG. So that's just like a good story. And Kurt became like a good friend. He always took care of us, signed our stuff. Because again, he ignored fans. He stayed in gimmick. He wasn't going to pose with people or sign the stuff. Very rare that he did that. But a good guy. He never mean to fans maliciously. Just stayed in gimmick, you know?
Yeah.
And we gave him a ride one time back to the hotel. And I swear we could have sat in the car till the sun came down talking baseball, but we had to get back. Me and my friend, you know, we had to get back to New York. I said, "Kurt, we gotta go."
I love those times when you're able to sit back and you're just having this endless conversation with, like, it just feels like, you know, two old friends who've known each other for years, and you're having these conversations. It's just laughing, having a good time. There's nothing that beats that. I mean, even as from collecting standpoint, you know, last year we went to the National Sports Convention there in Atlantic City, and many of us had never met before. So we'd met each other through email, and then email through a phone call, and then phone call through Zoom, but we never physically met each other. It's like that.
Yeah.
So it was fun that the best time for me, and I think some people as well would say, was after our panel where we discussed wrestling cards, we went and had dinner. And even though it was only six of us, it was probably the most fun, connected time we'd have with other collectors, just shooting the shit, talking about everything, just even outside the hobby itself. And that's what's kind of, these stories are always so cool to hear about from other people.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. It's great to meet people and see them in person, their passion, their collecting. I mean, it's a great hobby. I mean, some of the most fun times of my life was waiting for that Monday Madison Square Garden card, not only to watch the wrestling, but knowing I was going to go to the hotel and meet some wrestlers. And sometimes new guys came into the area and you say, "Oh, I hope they'll be at the hotel so I can meet them." And I remember when I met the Ultimate Warrior for the first time, you know, again, his gimmick was Queens, New York, and that's where I'm from. So when I saw him, he was really nice, by the way, you know, Warrior was super nice. This was his first match at MSG. I said, "What's this Queens, New York thing?" I said, "Are you really from there?" He started laughing, and he says, "I have a good friend from there." And I just kind of had in my head, Queens, New York was going to be where my hometown was. And I just thought that was hysterical. I thought, "Jim, that's where I'm from." And he was just such a great guy. And we took pictures, and that's where one of my most treasured photos, you know. And then he said, "I heard you take photos at the matches." And I know. And I said, "Yeah, I do." He says, "Well, if you get some, can you let me know or give me some? I'll be happy to pay you." I said, "No problem." So we saw him another time, and we had these great photos. I was, "Oh, man, he's a great." He goes, "How much do I owe you?" I said, "Jim, it's cool. Just sign a couple and we'll call it a draw here, you know?" He goes, "Oh, no problem." Yeah. So just, again, another way to get in with a wrestler. He just sees these guys followed up what they said. They brought the photos and the wrestlers loved them. That was just real quick. How I got in with a lot of wrestlers was giving them photos. Rick Rude loved the photos. And that's how me and Rick Rude got friendly, was because I gave him photos. And Jim
Nye, two of my all-time favorites you've mentioned now, Rude and Perfect. Those are two of my all-time favorites.
Yeah, two of mine also. And I'll give you a quick 30-second story. So Jim Neidhart and Rick Rude were going to travel after the matches. So we're in the parking lot, and Rick had told me to meet him after the matches. So I was giving some photos. Neidhart says, "Can you leave this guy alone already? What's your problem?" And Rick says, "Jim, calm down. I invited this guy over. He gives me photos. He's a nice guy." And Jim started tugging his beard like he saw on TV, and he was getting all red. And Rick was telling him, "Calm down. I know these guys. They don't want anything. You know what I mean?" And it was
because
just funny.
Because those guys are so used to, you know, people just wanting stuff and, right. and wanting to hang out and then just kind of, you know, loitering almost, you know, kind of thing. And here you are getting vouched by, you know, a legend guy himself. And so they're just used to that. I guess they're used to this guys hanging out, loitering all the time, you know?
Yeah, Jim stayed in kayfabe. I mean, it took me, I guess, 5 years. He finally signed one item for me. And it was only because I had his 85 OPC rookie card. I was the first to have it. I said, "Jim, I know you're going to sign my program now. I know you want this card." And he goes, "Let me see that." Now he grabs it all of a sudden, and he's looking it over, and he's showing it to Brett. And I'm going to tell you, Brett was fucking furious because Brett didn't get a card in that set, but Jim did. Brett was really pissed. I can tell that story to you. So I give Jim the card. I said
like that because I wonder, like, do the wrestlings care about, you know, funny you say that, you know, that does one person care who's in another set or, you know.
Brett did. Brett was legit hurt. That not because his brother-in-law had a card. He was very happy for him. I want to say that. Jim and Brett were extremely close, but he felt like, why is Uncle Elmer in this set and I'm not? And that's Brett's words out of his mouth.
Well, Tony, maybe we're wrong then. Maybe people do care who else is in the set when you make one after all, huh?
Maybe they do. Yeah.
Well, you know, Brett takes stuff seriously. Yeah, but Brett takes stuff very seriously. You know, Brett, sure. I like Brett. Brett was always very nice to me because I knew a lot of his friends. So Brett would take pictures of me, but he would not pose with fans when he was a heel. He just, unless he absolutely knew you, he would not do it. Because he said, "I got to stay in this persona. I got to." He believed it, but not in a bad way. You know, people say bad things about Brett, and I don't know. I like Brett, passionate about the business, and you can't be mad about that with a guy, you know?
I've heard stories about him and Owen when they had that run in around WrestleMania 10, and they stayed in character, and he's two brothers. And one day they slipped in a fence and I knew you guys really loved each other.
And they were so close, the two of them, legit. You know, I mean, as brothers, they were so close, and it was so hard for them to, you know, not travel together and not talk, you know, and it just got to a point where we're just competitive in the ring, you know, but we love each other, but in the ring, we'll do what it takes to, you know, that was kind of his in-person.
They protected the shtick. Business. Kayfabe was alive and well back then. And they protected it. It was important to them. In fact, someone posted yesterday a video of Vince Sr. where he was being interviewed. And someone said,
Is this just
filmed entertainment where it's predetermined? And he said, "Oh, baloney. Absolutely not." You know, whatever. and that's the way, you know, that's the way they lived back then. And that's the era that your photos are coming from, where these guys, you know, so you might have two guys that you photographed together that storyline wise shouldn't have been seen together.
Shouldn't have been together at all. That's why it's so cool to see.
Well, that happened in upstate New York, that the Iron Sheik and Hacksaw Jim Duggan, who were enemies, they got caught by cops and they had dope on them. And meanwhile, on TV, they were feuding with each other, you know. So
that was the dumbest thing ever. I mean, I've seen heels and faces, of course, travel together, but they would try to stand away from each other in the parking lot. But you knew they were going into waiting for the same car. But it was never guys in feuds. For the Sheik and Duggan to even do that was really stupid. Even one of those guys couldn't have got a ride from anybody. Sheik, wrestlers like Sheik, a fun guy. Hacksaw is a beautiful guy. Everybody loves Hacksaw. They didn't need to travel together. That just was a really bad idea.
Yeah. Interesting.
Fun, we could sit here and probably have stories upon stories upon stories, and I'd love to hear them all. And it's just great.
Yeah, we'll have to have you back.
We'll do a follow-up.
Even that night, Tony, in Atlantic City, when we were up until 2:30 in the morning, you'd show me a picture. And I'd say, "Oh, there's Vince." And there'd be a little story that went with that photo. You talk for 5 minutes on that night. And then the next one. And that's what's great, Alan, about your pictures is that they're locked in your head. I'm a big Harley fan. And one day you turned up with a classic. You as a kid in Harley race. I'm like, yeah, we're around the same age. So that would have been me and Harley back then, around that time. So it was just so incredible to see, you know.
Yeah. And Harley, I want to just say, was one of the nicest human beings you could ever meet. Like, the first time I met him, I didn't know what to expect. I'm thinking, is this gruff guy I've seen on TV? He's probably going to be mean. my goodness, what a nice human being, just a nice guy. And every one time I joked, I said, Harley, we have 7 photos together. I showed him, I got more photos of you than I got my mom. And he just gave me like this snicker. He didn't want to laugh and like break character kind of, but he was like shaking his head. He found that funny. But just a great guy, Harley Race. I want to just shout him out because he was somebody that was always extremely nice to people. And I want to, you know, recognize that out there. Just a really, really great guy, Harley Race.
Nice.
Well, like Tony says, we could talk all day long. I mean, you know, you two combined with all the guys that you've met, you know, all the stories that you've had, you know, have you ever thought before I let you go, Alan, about maybe doing some sort of journal or some sort of book that sort of outlines your sort of time with these wrestlers and what you've done over the years?
It's funny. I've attempted to. It's funny. It's something I wanted to do. I felt like it would be interesting. And I did reach out to some publishers and I got shot down every time. And I never understood why. And again, I'm not judging other wrestling. I've seen a lot of wrestling books come out, get published, and I'm not going to knock any of them publicly. But I'm like, really? This crap got published? This is garbage. And then, you know, and I'm like, I got a book
still put photos. Still write them all down. You have it all down and prep ready to go. Just go ahead and put it all down anyways.
Yeah. You know, all joke aside, I have it all in my head. Like if you said to me right now, Al, we're writing a book and I'm your editor. Let's go. Here's a tape recorder. I can do it all verbatim. You know, I just really have that kind of, you know, I can do it. So if you said to me tomorrow, guys, we're doing a book, Al, I can probably write all 10 chapters in a day.
Yeah, just voice the text real easy right there. Have it all put down on your computer right there for you. Just so you have an actual physical record of it now, in addition to your photos. I mean, what a great book it would be to have the visual aspect of what you've taken over the years and then having the stories behind it to coincide with that. I mean, every one is a chapter all by itself.
That's why I came to
mind. No, I appreciate that. I really want to do it. If you guys think that could be a moneymaker or something, or maybe if you have something, let me know. I'd love to cut you guys in on it. Of course, you know, we can all make some money.
You have so many original pictures, you know, and of course, you know, the notion of actually grading them and selling them out, but you know, they're your pictures, you retain the rights of them. So, you know, to get those in a book somewhere and you know, so the people out there understand, we're not talking about a dozen pictures. We're talking about hundreds of everybody, you know, the top names that have ever existed in wrestling. You know, the governor has, they're there. Like,
no,
I'm never shocked anymore when you pull out somebody, because like, of course, you know, it's sad to say, but someone will pass away and there's Alan the next day with that picture, you know, and it's like, of course you've met such and such, you know, because you've just been doing it for so long. And like you say, and it occurred to me, is like a guy like this doesn't get access and get to meet so many people unless he's a decent guy. And he's a guy that, quote, like they like to have around, you know what I mean? Yeah.
No, I appreciate you saying that. You know, that's very nice of you to say, and it's very true, because you can get invited to one event, act like a jerk, act like an idiot. You'll never get invited again.
Yeah,
never get invited again. Word gets around. Al's da 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 da, Tony da da da, and then that's it. So you know, when you behave and you act like one of the boys and just enjoy, they're like, oh, he's good to have. We'll push on the list next time, and it just keeps going like that. And that's the way to do it. You know, it's easy breezy.
I got one last question. I got to know it's like that. Where the hell did the name the governor come from?
Yeah.
So I also do nightlife. I don't know if you guys know about that. I do a lot of clubs. I've been doing clubs for, again, a long time. My friends own clubs and I've been going to clubs. So people just said, Al knows his way around. He knows everybody. He's always glad handling with everybody, you know, shaking hands and kissing babies and showing everybody a good time. He's the fucking governor, you know? And I was like, it's kind of a cool name.
I now envision Alan as the guy from that one shot scene from Goodfellas, going into the backstage areas like that, in the restaurants like that, that whole shot, puts a table right out front for him, it's like that. Hey, how you doing? Oh, hey, got 20 for you and a 20 for you. That's how I envision this now.
No, I appreciate it. Yeah, I love nightlife. So, you know, I meet a lot of people. I go out a lot. So you meet a lot of people, and people just hire me to kind of like, Al, run this club tonight. You know, you're in charge of this party. And I just love people and I want everybody to have the best time possible. So I just like that name. And I just said, that's going to be my handle from now on, is the governor. And
the governor.
Yeah.
Well, listen, man, thank you. Thank you so much. Not only for showing up to this afternoon with me and Tony, but for posting all the pictures you tell everybody your Twitter handle and where they can see all your stuff. And guys, you really want to do this. You want to look up the governor, Alan Barcoff, and just scroll through and you're going to be knocked out when you see how many pitchers and how many wrestlers, not only wrestlers, but particularly within wrestling, that Alan is known. So tell us where we can find you, Alan.
So yeah, on Twitter, you can find me just under my real name. I always use my real, besides the Gumnar, I really use my real name so people can find me. So just A-L-A-N, and my last name is B as in boy, A-R-C-O-F-F, Frank Frank. You can find me on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook under that name. So, and I have a lot of my photos on all my various social medias, so you can always check them out.
Nice.
Nice. Tony, normally you're asking me first, but just
yeah,
in case
anyone doesn't know who you are. Like, it's so weird. I'm the co-host this time. It's kind of weird for me, man.
But, what is it? Whoever starts talking first is how it goes, right?
Is that how it goes? All right. Yeah, everything for me is wrestlingtradingcards.com. You can find all of our social media handles at the bottom of every single page of the website. We continue to keep growing. Over 20 years now of providing checklist information for wrestling cards. I thank everybody for using the site. And for you, sir, good sir, where can they find you?
Paul and Ann, Wrestling Card Price Guide, but also I do a show every month with Tony called Three Count. So look for us in around the end of the month, and we let you know what's going wrong with prices. We do our market analysis, sort of hobby news. You know, we're the guys that are sort of, you know, guys on the scene or behind the scenes in the hobby, sort of letting you know what's going on. So
you guys are amazing. I just want to really thank you for having me on the show and for accepting me on Twitter and, you know, kind of co-signing me to a new audience, you know, and retweeting my stuff and saying, Al's a good guy. It means a lot to me. I really, really want to be on the show and say
I really bring something to the table, my brother. It's like every day is a new day.
Thank you.
I mentioned that to you once. It's like, you know, I love seeing what Alan's going to pull up from his sleeve next, because it's just so entertaining, you know, and that's what these things are supposed to be, you know.
Yes,
Same thing over and over again, but, you know, and I like to be that way on Twitter, post different things to get people thinking about things that we don't talk about all the time, same old, same old. And with your stuff, it's always a treat. So thanks again, brother. Really appreciate it. So everybody, the one and only.
Love you guys. Appreciate it.
Thanks, guys. We'll see you all soon. Thanks for watching, guys.
Ciao.